Praise the Lord, saints. Welcome to another Bible study here at Friendship Mission Church for the homeless and the poor. Pastor and founder Vince Rosato here in Montgomery, Alabama. My name is Minister Warren Rudd. I'm a licensed minister by my Bishop Jimmy A. Ellis III out of Victory Christian Center of Philadelphia in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Tonight's service is going to be on the child who is God. Now, isn't that wonderful? The child who is God. So get your Bibles, your papers, and your pens. Sit back and get ready for a mighty word from God. And as I always say, there you go, right there. God bless.
Starting at verse 1, we'll try to read the whole chapter. Alright? Please do not cross the video path. Thank you. Isaiah 53, starting at verse 1. Who has believed our report? And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? The word arm name means the power of the Lord. For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant and as a root out of a dry ground. That dry ground they represent here. And that word is birth. Amen? He has no form nor comeliness. In other words, Jesus wasn't no fine. He wasn't no good to wait. He had no form or comeliness. And when we shall see him, there is no beauty that we shall desire him. He is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. Amen. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. Verse 5. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. All we are like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He is brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before the shears is dumb. So he opened not his mouth. Verse 8. He was taken from prison and from judgment. And who shall declare his generation? For he was cut off out of the land of the living, for the transgression of my people was he stricken. And he made his grave with the wicked and with the rich in his death, because he had none. Because he had done no violence, neither was any deceit in his mouth. Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He has put him to grief. When thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed. He shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. He shall see of the travail of his soul and shall be satisfied. By his knowledge shall my righteous servant justify many, for he shall bear their iniquity. Therefore will I divide him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he has poured out his soul unto death. And he was numbered with transgressors, and he bare the sin of many. Amen. And made intercession for the transgressors. Let us pray. Father, I just thank you for this word that's about ready to come forth. I just thank you for those who are here. I pray that everyone have a very merry Jesus birthday for the Sunday that's going to come. So let your manservant walk on the word of your word. Let me decrease so that you may increase. And I just ask that everybody not only get a physical blessing, but a spiritual blessing. They grow spiritually, body, spirit, and soul. And I ask these things in Jesus' name. Let the house say amen.
Amen.
All right. As we saw, that is the prophecy right there. That's the prophecy of the coming of the Messiah that was written in the Old Testament. So this was prophesied before Jesus even came. Amen?
Amen.
So this is the prophecy of the Old Testament. Okay? Now, I want you to go to Luke chapter 2. My sermon tonight is going to be the child who is God. All right? Jesus is what? The Son of God, right? But we want to see that the child who is God. Amen? So I got a lot of scriptures. We're going to flow through this as quickly as we possibly can. And if you want to call this my Christmas sermon, I don't focus on things like that. Amen? So the thing the Lord asked me to bring in you, praise God again.
Amen?
I don't focus on Christmas trees, Santa Clauses, presents under there, reindeers, Rudolph. I don't focus on stuff like that. But I do focus on my God, my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen? Amen. So we're going to go to Luke chapter 2, because Luke is the most detailed book about Jesus' life. Amen? All the world should be taxed. Now that word tax there don't mean money. It means the people should be counted. So everybody has to be counted. They wanted to give a census of how many people there were. So that's what that meant. And this taxing was first made when Cyrenius was governor of Syria. And all went to be taxed, everyone in his own city. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth, into Judea, unto the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and the lineage of David. We know that our Lord must come out of the line of David. Amen? Amen. There it is. Verse 5. He came out of the lineage of David to be taxed with Mary, his espoused wife, being great with child. And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in a swaddling cloth and laid him in the manger because there was no room for him in the inn. There was no room at the hotel. All right? Verse 8. And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And look, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone around about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. You shall find a babe wrapped in a swaddling cloth, laying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly hosts praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace and goodwill toward men. That means both male and female. But one of the things about the prophecy in Isaiah, you knew that dry ground was Mary because it was of a virgin birth, meaning there was no male sperm in her that brought forth this Lord and Savior. Amen? He was born of the Holy Ghost. Amen? One of the things I like, my bishop had wrote something, and it blessed me. And I was looking at it, I even told him, I said, man, I got to say this, you know, because I saw this revelation in it. See, once you start getting past the knowledge of God, because God's going to fill you, because my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. But when are you going to move that knowledge into his wisdom, into his spirit? Because I think a lot of people know the word, but they got no spirit of it. Right. Amen. Right. Even the devil knows the word. And I could tell, you know, me and Ron was just talking about this, I could tell who's really seeking God. Because if you just want to get into a controversial conversation, or do you want to get into the Spirit of God? You know, I see Lamar read his word, I see him pray. I see Jeffrey read his word and pray. I see a lot of you brothers around here read your word and pray. That tells me you're seeking the Spirit of God. But are you just seeking so you can have a conversation? Amen. I used to do that myself. Amen. Amen. But one of the things I want to say that my bishop said, he said, Jesus, our Lord and Savior, was born in a barn. Do you know why he was born in a barn? Now, he's called King of Kings and Lord of Lords, but he was born in a barn. Can you imagine why? To be connected and have accessibility to all people. If he was born in a palace, you would have had to request to see him. Think about that. So if he was born in a palace, can you just walk in and go see President Obama?
No.
Can you even just go walk in and see the mayor or governor of Alabama? You have to have permission to come in. So Jesus, God, chose a barn. Why? Here's why. But he chose a barn for anyone to come into. From royalty, which was the wise men, because the wise men were royalty. They were next to the king. They had just as much power as the king. Now, like I told you before, there was more than three wise men. We're going to see that in a minute. Down to the shepherd. Who is the shepherd? The shepherd was the lowest job in the country. So, down to the normal, everyday person have free access and connection to Jesus. That's why you ain't got to have nothing special to come unto him. He chose a barn. How many people can just walk through a barn? I mean, down here, you go through somebody's barn, they might get shot. But, they think you're trying to steal something. But I thought that was wonderful that our God said, you know what? I'm going to take the lowest possible state so that all mankind, whether they're rich or poor, they have free access to me. And that free access is to what? From your heart. Amen. Let's go to Matthew chapter 1.
Matthew 1.
Now, all these scriptures that I'm getting ready to hit you with is going to point to you, and I hope you take notes. If somebody asks you how you know Jesus is God, you'll be able to look up these scriptures and prove that he's God. Amen. The same baby that Mary had made her. Ain't that amazing? Have you ever thought about that? Yeah, the same baby that Mary had made her. Think about that for a minute. She birthed God, who made her. That's so big, isn't it? It's like, man, how can I conceive that in my head? Amen. Because he's God. Ain't nothing, nothing's impossible with him. You start questioning his capabilities, then you're not trusting. You're still trusting yourself. I've seen some amazing things. Matthew 1, look at verse 23 and 25. Matthew 1, verses 23 and 25. And it says, behold, a virgin shall be with child, and shall bring forth a what? Son. And they shall call his name Emmanuel, which being interpreted means what?
God
with us.
Amen.
Verse 24. Then Joseph, being raised from the sleep, did as the angel of the Lord had bidden him, and took unto him his wife, and knew her not till she had brought forth her firstborn son, and he called his name
Jesus.
But he knew her not. That means he had no sex with her. You know, Joseph and Mary had plenty of sons and daughters after Jesus. Jesus had plenty of brothers and sisters. He didn't know that, you know that now. He was just firstborn. So that word, he knew her not, means he didn't have no sex with her until after Jesus' birth. But I like to say this, at least he got to know her first. I mean, y'all got to get to know who you're with first before you do something. There it is. He knew her not. So she became his wife. Yeah, some of y'all smiling. Well, I got to know mine before then, right? Amen. Amen. So, the baby she took care of made her and the world. If Jesus is not God, you can't be saved. If Jesus is not God, you can't be saved. He's not the Son of God. He's not a great prophet. He is all these things. But if that's all he is to you, then guess what? You ain't saved. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. It's just that simple. It ain't that you know the Bible from cover to cover. Knowing the Bible won't get you in.
Amen.
Amen. Knowing the Bible don't get you saved. Where your heart is gets you saved. Amen. I know plenty of people don't know the Bible, but they know more about God than I could ever know. They barely can read, but they know God better than me. You know why? Because their heart and relationship is right with God. They have a prayer life. I don't know why I keep saying that, right? I've been on that for about a few months with y'all. How many of y'all are getting a prayer life? Amen. That's small, man. That's sad. How many of y'all are afraid to talk to God? Y'all ain't afraid to talk to no hula on the street, nobody who gets up in your face. If somebody was ready to do you wrong, you'd have no problem pretending you're tough. But you have a problem talking to the man who created you? To the God who formed you? What are you afraid of? I tell you what, the devil got you blind. Stand up and start talking to your father and watch him bless you and change your life.
Very important.
Excuse me?
It's important that we just put that out there about our prayer life. Although we might have one.
I'm just saying that this is not a time for debate. You just grab it, eat the meat, spit out the bone. But my point is, if you ain't talking to God, I question your relationship with God. Aren't you going to talk to somebody you love? Do you love God, amen?
Yes, I do.
Do you talk to the person you love?
Yes, I do.
Then that's what I'm talking about.
Yes,
that's all I'm talking about. I'm going to talk to people I love. If you claim you love him, then you will talk to him. Just that simple. God gets angry when his children don't talk to him. Just that simple. And he really gets mad when you lie to him, knowing he knows all things. Ain't gonna sit up here and lie to the God who knows all things. You gonna sit up here, I didn't do that, God. I was just looking at you. I knew you were.
Good. That's the most ridiculous thing I've ever seen. I didn't do it. He sees all, knows all. And it's everywhere at one time. You want to sit up here and lie to God? Man, it's amazing to me. But prayer life is important. It's just that important. Amen. Go to Matthew chapter 2, start at verse 1. Now, when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, in the days of Herod the king, behold, there came wise men from the east to Jerusalem. Now, you don't see it says three. Does it say three?
No.
It says wise men. Yes. Because there was many of them. Okay? And they were called magi's. Okay? They were astrologers. And they were following that sign, that star in the sky, for over 2 years. And I'm getting ready to prove it to you. So that tells me that Jesus had to be at least how old? 2 years old. They wasn't at the manger. Changing your Christmas story again, huh? You know, me and Mrs. Steele, we were right at the Baptist Hospital, and we saw the divinity scene, and Steele said, now I know you ever drove that car, Rick, and watch. I said, no, I ain't gonna worry about it here, man. Let them have their Christmas, and man, they have it. But it was just so funny, you know. All right, verse 2. Say, where is he that is born, King of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east, and are come to worship him. When Herod the king had heard these things, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And when he had gathered all the chief priests and scribes of the people together, he demanded of them where Christ should be born. And they said unto him, in Bethlehem of Judea, for thus it is written by the prophet, and thou, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, art not the least among the princes of Judah, for out of thee shall come a governor that shall rule my people Israel. Then Herod, when he had privately called the wise men, inquired of them diligently of what time the star should appear. And he sent them to Bethlehem and said, go and search diligently for the young child. And when you have, watch this, and when you have found him, bring me word again, that I may come and worship him also. You know he's lying. Mm-hmm. Yeah. When they had heard the king, they departed, and looked, the star, which they saw in the east, went before them till it came and stood over where the young child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceedingly great joy. And when they were come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary, his mother, and fell down and worshipped him. It didn't say in the manger. Did it say in the manger?
No.
Did it say it in the barn?
No.
It said when he just saw the young child. Mm-hmm. With his mother. It didn't say no swaddling cloth before. We saw he was with shepherds wrapped in a manger. Here, it says what? They came into the what? House with a young child. Mm-hmm. So apparently they moved out the barn. Huh. Right. Amen. Changing y'all Christmas story. I'm just putting in the truth. It's the word, not me.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. And fell down and worshiped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented unto him gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And being warned of God in a dream that they should not return to Herod, they departed into their own country another way. Amen. Let's keep reading. How far are we going? 16? Yeah. And when they were departed, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared up to Joseph in a dream, saying, arise and take the young child and his mother and flee into Egypt, and be thou there until I bring thee word. For Herod will seek the young child to destroy him. When he arose, he took the young child and his mother by night and departed into Egypt, and was there until the death of Herod, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the Lord, by the prophet, saying, out of Egypt have I called my son. Ooh, look at that. Verse 16. Then Herod, when he saw that he was mocked of the wise men, was exceedingly wroth, and he was mad. And sent forth and slew all the children that were in Bethlehem and in all the coast thereof, from when how old? From 2 years old and under, according to the time which he had diligently inquired of the wise men. You see that? Mm-hmm. So it couldn't have been a baby in a manger. How many of y'all just got blessed by that?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. How many of y'all changed your Christmas story?
Amen.
The truth. Now the truth. Once you know it, wakes you up. These Christmas trees and lights, oh, it's wonderful. Don't get me wrong. Enjoy yourself. But don't put God on it. It's paganism. My idea of Christmas is blessing you every time I get a chance to. How many of you give a gift all year?
Amen.
Amen.
How many of you give a gift all year? If it's just laid upon your heart to go bless somebody, do you just do it? There have been plenty of times when God just told me, go buy suits. Go do this. Go do that. Give that person this. Give that person that. There were times I had a hard time doing it. But when I began to see the results of how much joy came in my life from doing it. And then, when times got hard for me, how God kept me covered. Because I obeyed him. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. All right, let's look at some more here. Let's go to Colossians chapter 1. We're still talking about the baby who will be God. Colossians chapter 1, let's look at, now open up your mind's eye with this. Amen. There's a lot of things that I'm teaching you now is what I've learned in Bible school. And like I said, you eat the meat, spit out the bone. I can read a verse, and God ministered to me on it in a different way he ministers to you on it. Remember? Okay? He ain't going to talk to me the same way he talks to you. You know why? Because my circumstances are different from yours. You know? I'm not struggling with the same sins that y'all struggling with. But there was a time I did, and he spoke to me in that manner. But when I got delivered from that, he'd be like, oh, now you walk. I want you to look at this sin you're doing. I want you to look at this one you're doing. Each step is growth toward him. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. It's not open for debate. The thing about God is this. If it ain't simplistic, because Jesus said everything I'm telling you is simplistic. You should be able to come to the Lord. It's so simple. It is so simple. It is nothing heavy about believing in Jesus. But all this other stuff that we're doing, just say, wait till I get to heaven and ask God, and he'll give me the answer. Agree to disagree. It is not, if it's not a heaven or hell issue, let it go. Just let it go. It ain't that big of a deal. But when Jesus said, don't debate his word, now you sin. Because you're too busy debating. You're too busy arguing. Now you're sinning. I had to learn that too. I ain't debating with you. God bless you. You know what I mean? Really? But that's stupidity in my book. And I was one of the biggest, stupidest persons you would ever want to be, because I always had to be right.
Amen.
And ain't that prideful and sin always have to be right? No, if God's speaking to you about it, God bless you. Move on. You know, I can't wait to get there and talk to Adam and ask him, why the heck did he smack that serpent? You know, I want to talk to a whole bunch of them. When I get up there, I'm going to ask him, what's happening to you, man? Some of y'all won't be here, you're going to say, go to hell. But, hey, Jesus! And be like, I never knew you'd depart from me. Woo, Lord. No, I want him to give me welcome. Come into my faithful son. Enter into thy rest. Man, I can't wait for that. I can't wait for that. Where are we going? Colossians 1. And we're still talking about the baby who was God. Colossians 1. Colossians 1. Looking at verses 12 and 15. And it says, giving thanks unto the Father, which has made us meet. That means comfort. The word meet is on PJ, the word for comfort. To be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in life, who has delivered us from the power of darkness, and has translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son, in whom we have what? Redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins. Who is the image? Now, that word here, if you're in the Bible, you should write that down. This is a word that usually confuses people, but hopefully I'll be able to convince you. Who is the image of the invisible God? Did y'all see that? He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of every creature. That word image means he's a stamp of God. So for people who walk with Jesus and said they've never seen God, he scratched his head. I'm the image, the invisible image of God. What does that word stamp mean? How many of you ever worked in an office and they had the signature stamp? And you know, your boss has a stamp, or you put a stamp, or what's those people who stamp the paper, right? They stick it in here, boom. So if you were to take Jesus' face, stick it in here, and put it on paper, you will see God. Amen. That's what that means. So if you were to take Jesus Christ, stick his face in ink, and then put it on paper, you will see God. That's what that means. Amen.